Okay, so we've seen quite a few sets of data, and I think the majority of those data do support the idea that there is a sort of negative exponential in there somewhere. But what we are missing is the good quantitative agreement, i.e. that the numbers that you're getting from the data for the parameter k, say, is radically different from...
Yeah, performing assumptions.
Let's go back to the assumptions and have a look at
those. We have produced an extremely simple model, and we wouldn't expect to have good agreement with the the real data.
Do you have that unit 9?
Yes, unit 9 here. There were 7 assumptions, the first of which was that all sources of pollution cease. Okay, and for the PCBs, I think that is a realistic assumption.
I mean, I've got some data here, I've got some graphs here of PCBs and DDT in Michigan and Ontario. It's a bit awkward here because the time axis is upwards, so this is 1900 going up to 2000. And the PCB in Lake Michigan is actually this graph here. And, they're there. It's heavily used here. I mean, lots of use. Presumably it's sort of invented somewhere around about 1940, I don't know, but very little before then. And now it's really declining. So probably we can say that...
Mm. Well, there have been efforts to eliminate PCBs, so...
Okay.
It seems to me that the first assumption is quite a reasonable one.
Let's have a look at the second of our assumptions, and that is that the pollutant does not biodegrade in the lake.
Again, I think that's okay for PCBs.
Yeah, what we've read about PCBs was that they stay there and they don't change into anything.
There are several forms of biodegradation that could take place. The action of sunlight on certain chemicals changes the nature of those chemicals, breaks them down. I don't think that happens for PCBs. It could react with other chemicals in the lake, or it could just degrade over time, naturally.
Yeah. Okay, well, we'll probably have to think that it stays there, doesn't it?
Right. However, the fish are taking in these PCBs, and they're accumulating in the fish. So there is some additional
I'm not sure the lake is teeming with fish sufficient to take all the PCBs out. I think that should be an modelling assumption.
Okay, but for other pollutants, we would have to take that into account.
Okay. But if we're working with these, that's fine.
Okay, the third of our assumptions is that the pollutant that is initially present in the lake is evenly dispersed throughout the lake. That is that wherever we are in the lake, at whatever depth in the lake, we have the same level of concentration of pollutant.
Okay.
That one we may need to revise. I would expect that the concentration level near the shore of the lake would be greater, perhaps, where...
We do have a picture of pollution concentrations, don't we, for PCBs?
Yes, I mean, this is one we have here for PCBs here. I found this once again off the net. This here is 1991. There's quite a bit of variation, certainly the one we're looking at the moment, Huron mostly. There's a lot of variation there within the lake. Michigan, something... quite high around the edges, quite low down in the middle.
Yes, I certainly suggest perhaps some horizontal stratification might need to be considered.
Yeah, so it's not very uniform, is it?
No, certainly not.
And there is some evidence that there are hot spots, certain areas perhaps around by a factory, where the pollution levels are much higher, and it takes quite a while for that pollution to disperse into the rest of the lake.
Bill Richardson has something to say about this as well, so let's just hear what he says.
30 years ago, when we started working on the Delaware and on the Great Lakes, computers weren't very powerful. And one of the reasons to segment it in the large areas is because the more segments there are, the more computer time it takes to make the calculation. So in those early days of slow computers, or even hand calculators for that matter, we didn't have many segments off. But as computer technology is improved. Our ability to make these calculations have increased tremendously, so we can start looking at much finer spatial and temporal detail. What we're doing now for Lake Michigan actually is looking at every 5-kilometer grid point in the lake. We will make calculations, and we may need the Cray supercomputer in Bay City to do the calculation, but we can do it.
So that's dividing the surface of the lake into segments. But there's also the possibility of dividing it into layers, a sort of vertical arrangement.
How the water is stratified determines that homogeneity. So the epilimnium, which is the surface segment, would be defined as the top segment, and the hypolimnium as the bottom segment. And that's how a lot of the models are done. The surface layer has different characteristics, different temperature, different light penetration than the bottom waters, and that's why you'd have a two-layer model. The model we're going to be doing for Lake Michigan will actually have 5 vertical layers. Every 10 meters for the first 50 meters, and then from 50 meters to the bottom.
Well, dividing the surface into segments or the lake into vertical layers certainly seem to be important features that we might consider when we're revising the model. Yeah. What do you think, Lee?
Well, I think segmentation of the lake is extremely important, and in fact it's the topic of a major multimedia package associated with Unit 15.
Okay. In fact, I mean, this science segmentation was something they did in Saginaw Bay originally. So I think we ought to be looking at that, but not here.
Right.
But haven't we got another 4 assumptions that we ought to look at first as well?
Yes,
before
we ought to go right through them.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, let's have a look at the last 4. I think the next 3 are all pretty interconnected. The first is that water flows in and out of the lake at a constant rate. The second is that all other water gains and losses can be ignored, such as evaporation, extraction, and so on. And finally, that the volume of water in the lake is constant.
There certainly are going to be seasonal effects, aren't there, which affect the volume of water in the lake, but...
Yeah, but the data we've got, you see, is really from year to year.
Yes, so they're going to occur more frequently than the...
Yes, exactly. So it's going to actually wash away the seasonal effect. And I think we probably know there would be big outcry if the level of the lakes actually changed, wouldn't there? So I think we can say that the balance is right.
Yes, so in a more sophisticated model, you would take into account the fact that the volume is changing between May and December, for example.
Yes, yeah. But I think not far... simple revised model.
Right. So we can assume that the flow rate into and out of the lake remains constant.
Yes.
I think we can keep with those.
Mm. Okay, there is one final assumption, and that is that if we actually use our mathematical model for the lower lakes, we have to assume that there's no pollution flowing into the lower lakes from the upper lakes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. In fact, actually, the data we originally looked at was from Lake Superior, wasn't it?
Yes.
So which has got no pollution in it,
no
right?
Yes.
But I think we'd have to, if we looked at the other lakes, we might have to modify that.
And in fact, that is also covered in the multimedia package for Unit 15.
Okay, right, so that's covering that.